All right, you ready still?
I'm ready. The hunt for Atlantis leads us to the coast of the Black Sea in Bulgaria.
I see gold.
Where we're uncovering mysterious gold treasure from a lost people.
Whoa!
Is this the only one?
Only one in the world.
And evidence of an ancient catastrophe.
This area is extremely geologically active.
A massive geological event that could be the basis for Noah's flood.
I can't believe what I'm seeing!
And the disappearance of the most legendary lost city of all time.
It's amazing!
Like, right on the money!
The story of Atlantis is the greatest historical mystery of all time. And nobody can find any evidence for it because they're all looking in the wrong era. I'm Stel Pavlo, and I've been obsessed with Atlantis my entire life. Greek philosopher Plato wrote that Atlantis was the biggest superpower of its age, but a natural disaster caused it to sink beneath the waves in a single day.
Around 9600 BC. But I have a new theory that says that date is completely wrong. You see, ancient Egyptians measured time by using king lists that kept track of the years that each pharaoh ruled. The problem is, often two people would rule at the same time. Remove those double-counted years, and suddenly the timeline shrinks to Atlantis disappearing in the 5th millennium BC, and it changes everything.
Oh my God, amazing.
That's it.
I'm teaming up with geologist and explorer Jess Phoenix.
Oh, yeah.
Together, we're going to follow the trail of evidence to some of the most legendary locations around the world. This is the most comprehensive search for Atlantis ever.
Whoa!
And we're going to find it.
All right, Stel and Jess take a road trip in a really loud-ass Russian Jeep.
Yeah, Factor 3.
Oh my god.
We're heading for the modern port city of Varna, Bulgaria, along the Black Sea coast. It's home to a mysterious ancient graveyard full of gold. But this people's city has never been found.
Varna gold was 4600 BCE, right?
Yeah.
We know there were 300 graves. A bunch of them have not been excavated, but we can't find any sign of the town.
And the Varna culture seems to match what Plato says about Atlantis, right? They had gold and other metals. They were master metal workers. They had advanced knowledge of geometry.
So that's what we're going to go have a look at.
All right.
Yes.
Let's get there. All right.
At the Varna Archaeological Museum, Professor Hristo Smolenov is giving us special access to the gold artifacts from the Varna graves.
Oh.
I see gold. Oh my God. He certainly went to the afterlife with a lot of stuff, a lot of really amazing stuff.
Wow. Look at the workmanship. I've seen Middle Kingdom gold, I've seen King Tut's gold, and this is absolutely on the same level, but this
right.
is 2,500 years earlier. This is 4,600 BC.
Look at the bracelet.
Look at how perfect
these
circles are.
Hi.
Dr. Smolenov?
Dr. Smolenov,
yes. Okay, okay. Now, what can you tell us about this?
Well, he's the boss. He's the king and high priest of this community, which is responsible for the making of the oldest processed gold on Earth.
Wow.
That's incredible.
In this grave alone, there is more gold than elsewhere in the world from that period of time.
Oh my God.
The people responsible for this are also the sublime producers of copper. 1,000 tons of pure copper during...
1,000 tons?
That's so
1,000
much
tons of pure copper here in Varna.
That's industrial scale.
Yeah, this is all very advanced looking to me. So how does this fit into your hypothesis about Atlantis?
Well, they had to be advanced metal workers.
Yes.
They had to be warriors.
Right. It looks calculated, which you would need for an Atlantean.
Yeah, I mean, I'm seeing sort of geometric shapes.
Yes. All those tiny gold circles are of exactly equal diameters.
Wow.
Geometry meant a lot to those people.
How do we know
that? Can you show us?
Follow me.
Over here?
Yes. This is the famous symbolic grave number 4 from the Varna Necropolis. There is a gold-plated bowl, which is fantastic. First of all, the design is something very special. Then the size and proportions of this are remarkable.
Okay.
But the diameter of this bowl is exactly 52.4 centimeters, which is a match for the royal cubit, the sacred measure of ancient Egypt.
That's absolutely the same diameter as a royal cubit of Egypt.
Huh. Absolutely.
But it's way older.
2,000 years at least.
2,000 years before the pyramids.
Absolutely.
Yeah, okay.
But I want to show you something even more astonishing. It's a pure gold cast plate.
Gold.
Of fantastic proportions. You see, measuring
173?
Here, 173.81. Look, if we measure it from the other side.
Are you serious?
And this again, yes.
That is absolutely identical.
It's dead on.
It's interesting to me because you're talking about sacred geometry.
Yes.
Plato talks about sacred geometry.
He refers to a specific Atlantean proportion, 6 to 5. Six over five. The diameter between the holes.
Okay. Uh-huh.
Over the distance between the holes
is
6 to 5. And moreover, this diameter over this perpendicular is 22/14. This is the main proportion of the Great Pyramid.
Wow.
That's incredible.
Is there another example?
Oh, yes, of course. Look now. It looks like a flying saucer.
Yeah. Early
but
UFO.
It is a biconic bracelet, which doesn't seem to have any signs of being welded together.
Right.
It
That's
is
impressive.
One piece. It is fantastic. Wow. Its diameter from the inside exactly fits this fantastic cylinder.
So it
match.
Fits right in there. That's the diameter
exactly
of the bracelet.
The same.
Wow.
Mind you, those gold masterpieces are almost 7,000 years old. And when you see 2,000 years later, Egyptians, gods, and pharaohs holding this cylinder like this. Please remember the mother civilization born by the Black Sea 7,000 years before present, or maybe even earlier.
Thank you so much for educating us on this. It's really fascinating.
This Varna King looks a whole lot like a king of Atlantis. As great as these artifacts are, the really interesting part for me is where they were found. First of all, we have the Bosphorus Strait right here. This leads into the Black Sea, and there are theories that this area was the original Pillars of Hercules. Plato says that Atlantis was beyond the Pillars of Hercules, and of course, most importantly, they were destroyed in a flood. Geologists now know that at some point in the past, the Black Sea was a freshwater lake. There was an earthquake that allowed the Mediterranean to flow straight into the Black Sea, changing the coastline. The original coastline to the Western Black Sea is here. It's about 10 or 20 miles from where it is today. Nobody has ever found the Varna city. If the Varna city was hit by this flood, then their city is somewhere out here. If we can find the Varna city, then maybe we can find Atlantis. So next stop, just a couple of hundred yards off the Black Sea coast.
Wow.
Same conditions.
Yes, this is beautiful. What a great day for a dive.
Local diver Naiden Nedev is going to show us the remains of an ancient settlement that he's only just found.
So tell us about what you found out here.
I'll show a very interesting part of the Black Sea because in this small area, we can find the 3 ships and 1 village.
So we got 3 shipwrecks.
Yeah. Oh, wow.
And then we've got a village.
Yes.
Village is older.
Village is older. Yeah. Because many civilizations live here. This
part. Oh, yes. Layers.
And I really hope it's as old as Havana Gold. Let's suit up. That's
fantastic.
Yeah,
let's go do it.
Part of a wooden post coming out of it. Jess, this here. What do you make of this?
Yes, that looks like it was put there on purpose.
It's about the size of the span of my hand. There was a pretty substantial log driven into the ground here. So this is part of a structure.
That's part of a dwelling, then there should be more.
I think I found another one. This is another post.
Wow. Yeah, that's definitely a post. A really old one.
So we've got two so far. They're very close together. This is fantastic.
Another one, look.
Yeah, they're all over. This must have been a big settlement.
Okay, let's go up and try to figure this out.
That was incredible. I lost count of how many post holes we saw.
I know, there were so many.
I mean, some of those post holes were like, well, the posts themselves are like that big.
Yeah, they're huge.
I mean, there's so much activity here. We have to go find out exactly what we saw because it's just a big jumble.
Yeah, we need an archaeologist to go talk to bounce this off of.
South of Varna is the port of Sozopol, where preeminent Black Sea archaeologist Dr. Kalin Dimitrov operates a research vessel.
Ah, what a nice boat.
Oh, that is an incredible boat.
Yeah. So excited.
May we come aboard?
Yes, welcome.
All right. We just went diving in a spot that a local diver took us to. There were some archaeological finds on the seabed. And I need to make sense of what we saw. So is it okay if I show you a video?
Yeah, we'll be curious.
I don't understand the context, and maybe you do, but so this is what we saw. This area here, it looks to me like a post that was driven into the ground, and there were a few more around. And I was thinking maybe it was for a dwelling. Would that be correct?
Yeah, this was a settlement. We have found similar wooden posts during our excavations on submerged prehistoric dwelling sites.
Prehistoric sites. What were the ages on the ones that you did actually look at?
The oldest one dates back to the late Copper Age, which means the end of the 5th millennium BC.
Oh, okay.
So yeah. That's in the ballpark, yeah?
Yeah, it's in the ballpark. That means what we saw then, if that's the same as the others, then we're looking at a post that's like 6,000 years old? Yeah.
They are in total known till now around 20 such of sites.
So why were they building these houses on stilts?
These houses originally have been built on the ancient shoreline.
So the stilts were an adaptation to sea level rise that was happening, do you think?
It's difficult to say.
I'm really curious as to what your thoughts are about how rapidly the Black Sea may have risen, if it was all one big event, if it was a slow process over many years.
So there was a theory, very famous, about the Noah's flood in Black Sea, described in the Bible. But in fact, what we know nowadays is that the sea level changes doesn't happen so quickly. It took a couple of hundreds of years.
Right. Okay. There was flooding, but it's smaller and more gradual.
Very gradual.
So no huge catastrophe crashing through the Bosphorus, no like world cataclysm, no Noah's flood, nothing like that?
Yeah.
Well, thank you, Dr. Dimitrov, for blowing a huge hole in my theory. Dr. Dimitrov said that the freshwater lake that was the Black Sea flooded gradually over the span of about 200 years, which is, you know, all well and good, but it doesn't help me, because anyone who's read Plato's story knows this happened in 24 hours. A day and a night, and Atlantis was gone. It really does come down to this. Unless I can find a catastrophe here with hard data to support it, then the hunt for Atlantis in the Black Sea is dead in the water.
Dimitrov has thrown a complete spanner at works.
Yeah, I wasn't sure how you'd take that meeting. It's not kind to that hypothesis of the flood.
So we now know that there's no cataclysmic, singular Noah's event.
Yeah.
There's not one great big flood. In a way, actually, it makes sense what Dimitrov said, because Atlantis was, first of all, it was a confederation of 10 states, groups, okay, that work together,
yeah,
with Atlantis as the primary hub. And you can only trade with them once the Black Sea has flooded.
Right, because you need that shipping channel without the Bosphorus being navigable.
So that now makes sense, that the flood would have come first,
yes,
Atlantis comes second, and then something else wipes out Atlantis.
Something else.
Afterwards.
Okay, something else is my specialty. I mean, like the tsunami, earthquake, landslide, debris flow, mudslide, all of these things are connected to earth movement. All right, so I know I just kind of said, hey, get in the car, Stel, which can be a little bit shady.
All you said was mysterious sand.
Yeah, and okay, let me clarify what that meant. There's this deposit of sand. I want to go check it out, because if you find something like that, it can indicate there was a tsunami. You know, there was an event that caused a really quick incursion of sand in a place where it shouldn't be, or it could just be an ancient shoreline.
We arrive in Budzaka, just a few miles north of Sozopol.
So it's just this way.
Okay.
This mysterious sand deposit is now surrounded by a housing development. But what's weird is it's more than 100 feet above sea level.
So something really interesting about this site is that it actually contained graves of ancient people.
Uh-huh.
We're talking like Copper Age burials of humans. It was kind of like a necropolis. So
4,000 or 5,000 BC.
Exactly. And okay. I mean, as you can see, this stuff is not hard rock here. We're looking at sand. You know, I mean, this is pretty standard beach sand right here.
Right.
Yeah.
But this is on top of a Copper Age grave.
Yeah, several. And they're not exactly sure why that is.
Huh.
Yeah. So when we look at how sand gets moved, it's basically wind or water. Those are the things that put sand in different places. Wind, I would expect to see dunes all over the place here, and I just don't find that. It's only right around here.
It's right. Like this is kind of a weird sort of spot we're in, where there's a giant sand pile, and it doesn't look like anyone's put it here intentionally, at least not recently. Mm. So water, I mean, we'd see more. If it was like a tsunami, we'd see just so much more sand than what we actually do.
So it's not a tsunami.
Right.
It's not wind.
Exactly. And that's the big thing. I'm sitting here trying to go, what could have done this?
I mean, is there anything about geology or the rest of the region that could explain it?
Not that comes to mind, like, really easily. So this one, I mean, I don't know what it is, and it may be an example of the ancient people interacting with the landscape and gathering sand here for maybe to bury their dead, but, I mean, we don't really know. So I think we need to go and try to find context clues in the landscape from the surrounding area.
Yeah, let's get out of here.
All right.
So where are we going now?
Well, I've heard from some local folks that there's a sort of a geologic anomaly. We've got possible evidence of a fault in a cliff face that is above the current shoreline. So that's what we need to go look at, because it could be evidence of something cataclysmic.
Now we're heading 50 miles up the coast from Varna to Cape Kaliakra. With the help of a climbing team, Jess is going to look up close for a fault that could have caused the destruction of Atlantis around 5000 BC.
So this is what I heard about. You see those layers? You see how most of them are horizontal?
Uh-huh.
And you see how some of them look like they're just not? They're like kind of dipping a little,
right,
and maybe a little crunched up?
Mm-hmm.
That could be either something that's localized just to this area, like a small landslide, or it could be something that's bigger, like a regional event, like an earthquake. So I would like to get a closer look. So would you want to be my eyes on the ground here? And
sure.
Okay. This is the left, this is the break. Yep.
А с дясната да отпуска въжете.
Here goes nothing.
There she comes.
All right, we are gonna look at some stuff here. So, we have some layers and we are seeing deformation. All right, Stel, you copy?
I'm here.
Am I at that layer
that we initially talked about? Because I can kind of see that V.
Yeah, the V is like directly to your right.
Okay, getting some really nice limestone here. Stuff's really weak. Also, really bad in big earthquakes or landslides. Oh yeah, that, look at that. To me, this shows us that we're on the right track about something bigger
having an impact in this area, like something that would not just mess up
the local geology, but would have regional catastrophic effects. It just confirms that this area is extremely geologically active.
I mean, this is great.
That is fantastic news. Okay, it sounds like we've got what we need. So if you get down and we'll get going.
All right, well, I'll see you on the ground.
Wow, this is awesome.
So we have clear evidence of seismic activity within 50 miles of the Varna Gold. We still need evidence that earthquakes in this region could cause a city to sink into the sea. But Jess has a lead. A Bulgarian geology colleague asked to meet us just a few miles away from Cape Kaliakra at Cape Chirakma.
Professor, thanks for inviting us here. What is so exciting about this area for you?
Why we are here is because this is a very active landslide area, and it was activated very much by the seismic activity, which is generated by a source inside the sea.
So there's a big fault down there.
Exactly.
How strongly can that fault rupture? What magnitude?
It can generate earthquakes with a Richter magnitude about 8.
That's extremely strong.
8?
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah. So that's why we're here, right? Because we can see the landslides.
Exactly. They were activated by this seismic activity.
Well, I don't know about you guys, but I really want to see this via drone, so.
Let's do it.
All right. Wow, a beautiful limestone lake. Oh, right there, look at, you can see that. You've got the curve of the slide, and you see where they all detach.
This direction.
It's just landslide after landslide after landslide here. Oh yeah, right into the water.
That is massive. What is the history of activity here? I mean, is there anything recorded from any settlements here?
The last earthquake, which was triggered by this source here, was happened in 1901 with a magnitude 7.1.
That's big. Yeah. That'll wake you up.
We have data and information that this source was very active in the past times as well.
When in the past?
Yeah, how long ago?
In 1st century BC, the old Greek colony was sank in the sea waters because of the earthquake and the activated landslide.
So there was a Greek colony here.
Exactly.
There was a huge earthquake, and it just slid off into the sea.
That's right. Yeah. Even more, we have data about the earlier events.
How much earlier?
Maybe about 4,000
BC.
BC. Because just a few kilometers from here to the north, we detected the effects of same source on the very ancient settlement Durankuak.
Okay, so that fits the bill, right?
Fits everything.
Yeah, we needed a major cataclysmic event that has the strength to wipe out a pretty established and accomplished settlement.
Okay, I'm gonna go jump and be all excited.
Thank you so much.
Yeah, that's pretty much on the money.
Yeah, we need to go Durankuak.
Next stop, Durankuak, 25 miles north of Cape Kaliakra on the Black Sea coast. If we can show that Durankuak was hit by a devastating earthquake and that it's connected to the Varna King, we may be one step closer to his capital, and we may be closer than ever to finding Atlantis.
This is actually how I imagined Atlantis would look. Plato said it was on a fertile plain.
Oh, that's so cool.
Wow, this is huge.
Yeah, it's got little avenues here.
It's a proper town.
The excavation at Durankuak is brand new, and the archaeologist leading it, Dr. Vladimir Slavchev, has agreed to let us study the site.
Hi.
Thanks
to meet you.
Nice to meet you.
Welcome.
Thanks for coming.
This is the earliest place with stone architecture in continental Europe.
I mean, the buildings are like there's right angles and there's a street layout.
We are staying on the earliest corner of the ancient cities.
So this is the oldest street corner in Europe. So it's like Times Square.
Yes, or somewhere on the crossland of the Broadway Street.
I need a hot dog stand. You say it's the oldest stone structure, so how old is that?
About 4,900 years BC.
Wow.
Right on target.
Yeah.
And this is like Varna culture, is that correct?
The site were occupied by Varna culture about 300 years. The prototype of any kind of architecture like that you can see later during the Bronze Age in Troy, then in Greek periods, during the Roman times. So everything that we see here is the beginning of the civilization, beginning of the culture as we know it today.
Because I read that like street planning like this didn't occur till about 3000 BCE, so you just rewrote the history books.
Yes, but
that's great. I had a question though. We're looking for any evidence of catastrophic events like earthquakes or landslides, tsunami, anything like that?
Let me show you.
Oh, awesome.
All right,
here we go.
I can't wait to see this.
So, there we are.
Oh, wow.
It's collapsed.
This is cool. This is super cool. You wanted a catastrophe.
Yeah.
Earthquake.
Yes, you are absolutely right. The wall split it in two, we can see the falling of the wall in two different directions. You can split the wall only when you have a shake.
It's the way the waves move through the surface layer of the ground. You get side to side and you get wavy. And so
absolutely.
That would do this.
Absolutely.
These are substantial stones as well, so that could be a real good shaker.
There's nobody under them, right?
We don't know, but we'll see.
Okay.
No, seriously, what happened to the people?
In the beginning, they immediately ran away. And because of the earthquake, everything here fell down, it was damaged, and fire starts. And because of this fire, everything was left on the same places that it was.
Oh, because it was such a quick evacuation.
When did this happen?
It happened a little bit earlier than the middle of the 5th millennium BC.
So what kind of date?
4,600
years BC. 4,650. I mean, that's like right on the money.
How did you guys find that out?
Because of the study of the samples of wheat that we found there and radiocarbon dates that we
found. Radiocarbon dates.
Okay, now I can get excited because that is hard data. That's awesome.
Dr. Slachev's team is digging up evidence of a highly advanced society at Durankalak, a place where the Varna king could have lived. One house contains an oven used for smelting copper and gold. Another find suggests they had priests or kings.
For the very first time in human history, we have the first chiefs.
What?
So,
looks like coffee grounds.
Oh yeah.
These are the seeds of wheat.
So those are ancient wheat grains.
This is where you got
really
your carbon 14 dating.
Yeah.
Absolutely. So this is a proof, first of all, of agriculture. Second of all, of radiocarbon date that we have already done from there. And third of all, as you see, it turns to charcoal. Because of the fire.
Carbon. Right. So that, you dated to 4,600 BC?
Absolutely. And you ask why we are sure that these people left the houses so quickly. Not only because of the fire, but for example, these tools are also proof of it.
This is
a pin for tattoo.
It's a tattoo needle.
Oh,
yes.
Yikes. I have tattoos and that looks a little bit, that looks a little more unpleasant, but wow.
And this stone was used for smelting the paint.
Oh, so that was for making the ink.
Is that the color itself still?
Yes, absolutely.
Oh, so like a red ochre.
So they've like wiped it on there to pick up the ink?
Absolutely.
Wow.
Ancient tattoo ink.
The tattoo is a symbol also of social ranking. This is something that is very special.
They're building houses, they're building streets, and they're getting tattoos.
That's an advanced society. If you're getting tattoos, like...
Yeah, tats are pretty advanced.
Okay, so I really need to just take a minute and like organize all the different pieces of this puzzle.
We have a settlement that was destroyed by an earthquake and fire at around 4,650 BCE.
Right.
Okay, there were lots of people here. You had Varna.
Right, exactly.
They had metalworking, so they were highly advanced. I mean, these are straight, you know, 90 degree walls.
To my mind, the geology actually works for this spot.
Yeah, so. it was this, what's now a lake was a river, but then it flooded and became an island. And there's a really fertile plain all around. Mm-hmm. And then on top of that, we're only about 2 miles from the sea.
You can see it from here.
I mean, it checks so many of the boxes and is really, really close. But having said all of that and how so close we are, there's one big key problem. Can you figure it out?
Yep, I think I can. We're too far above the sea level.
We're not underwater.
Exactly. So
there's a bit of a problem there. The real Atlantis is going to be something like this.
Yes.
But out to sea.
But further that way.
Okay, it feels like we're on the right track. The only thing we're missing, we're not underwater.
What Plato described is a river that comes down through the mountains to a fertile plain behind the city.
In ancient times, the Danube came down to this point east of Varna. And I think if we look in this area, we've got a really good shot of finding Atlantis, but there are two major problems. The first one is this area is massive. And the second problem is that the Danube could well have silted over anything that remains of the original settlement. So we need a really large boat that can scan the sea floor. And it also needs to be able to take core samples.
If we're going to find Atlantis, we're going to need a bigger boat.
We found an ancient city on the Black Sea coast that was once home to one of the most advanced societies on Earth.
Wow, this is huge.
It was abandoned after a massive earthquake around 4,650 BC.
You wanted a catastrophe.
Exactly, when I believe Atlantis was destroyed. The only problem? It's above water.
Oi!
Oh, hello.
Permission to come aboard?
Come on board.
So we're heading out on a specially designed research boat. Konstantin Shterev is a geologist and the founder of the Black Sea Research Fund. His passion is the same as ours, to find a lost city on the seabed.
We just came from Durankalak.
Yeah.
And we're starting to think that there are more settlements further out to sea.
So it is difficult to search for submerged settlements right now in the Black Sea.
Okay.
Because the Black Sea is very muddy. It's, the sediments are so thick. Even you have a settlement, you'll not be able to see anything. So what we do is we do coring.
Okay.
And we try and we hope to find in the core remains of human activities.
So how does coring work?
Yeah, well,
coring works, you have a steel tube and you put the tube on the seabed, but the area we are interested in is very hard. You have rocks and sand and shells, so you need a vibro core. You need something that actually hammers the tube down.
Okay.
So, awesome. Yeah. Yeah. All right.
I'm so excited.
Konstantin heads to a site about half a mile out to sea, at a high point on the ancient shoreline, an ideal spot for a city like Atlantis.
This is our boat here. We are very close to the point where we want to drill, because this is sort of a high ground underwater. Obviously, we're looking for something like that,
right.
A higher ground than the normal surrounding seabed.
So we're right on top of it?
Yeah.
Okay.
So we will anchor and we'll start coring.
Let's get on it.
Let's get
on
it.
All right. They're trying to clear the fantail because it keeps hitting the back of the boat. And the waves, the way they are, we just keep bobbing up and down and it keeps slamming back. So hopefully, in a minute, they can get it clear and then they can drop it down.
So we are setting the frequency for 50 hertz and the test run was fine. So we are ready.
All right, let's do it.
That's it.
Let's get some core.
They got it. They got it. Yay!
Good job.
So it's going down about 15 meters, which in American is about 50 feet.
Cables. Up. Stop. Okay. Now you can start operating the machine.
All right, you ready still?
I'm ready.
All right, it's 50.00.
Okay.
All looks good. Here we go.
5 minutes.
There we go. Yeah. Just made a little noise.
Okay.
Yep.
5 minutes to go.
We're looking for fragments of pottery or any other evidence that people lived on this site, which would have been on the ancient coast in 5000 BC.
4.5 minutes.
So 30 seconds left.
Right.
Yeah, we're almost there.
5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
Stop.
And stop.
We need some help.
Stay clear, stay clear. Yeah.
No, I think I'm out.
All right, let's go.
All right. Whoa!
Okay. Oh, look at that, little fragments.
Shells.
Yep, shells, and more shells.
And no gold.
No gold, and, no pottery fragments that we can see.
No pottery.
Yeah.
Unfortunately.
The shells are pretty.
Yeah, but look at the actual sand.
Welcome to Atlantis.
Over the next hour, we send the rig back down twice more, probing other parts of this ancient hilltop.
Up the door.
There we go.
This is what we got.
Yeah, I mean, hey, science is a process.
It is a process, yeah. This time we didn't have enough luck. Sorry about this. But I'm leaving this.
Yeah, leave that there. Yeah.
That was anticlimactic.
Yeah, I mean, I hoped we would get something better, but hopefully we can, you know, find some more clues that will help us keep going forward with this.
Yeah, it's, I mean, there is so much out there.
As the sun sets on the last day of our investigation in Bulgaria, Konstantin gets a tip from a colleague about an incredible artifact he's just pulled off the Black Sea floor.
Dr. Gordiev!
Hi, Stu and Jess.
Yes.
Welcome.
All of these were found off the coast here?
Yes, but here is the very strange artifact.
Holy cow! That's an oxide ingot.
This is the mix of metals.
Uh-huh.
Gold and silver and copper.
Wow!
This is the pre-coins form of trading.
So before money. This is pre-money. Money.
This is pre-money.
Pre-money.
And it's shaped like leather.
Is this the only one?
Only one in the world.
Is this from here, or did this come to here?
This is from Egypt.
It's Egyptian.
Oh.
Yeah, it's Egyptian.
Ooh.
So
the plot thickens.
Well, yeah. I mean, we're looking for trade. We're looking for trade routes that go from this part of the world to Egypt and back. Because I'm trying to work out how the story got from wherever Atlantis was to Egypt.
And who is Egypt trading with? The Varna?
Yes, I think to the Varna civilization.
Okay. So this is a definite link.
Yeah, this is exciting.
This is huge. That oxide metal ingot really gets me thinking. It came from Egypt. And Egypt is how Plato learned of the story of Atlantis. So we're looking for these trading connections. But there's one other thing that Plato talks about. Atlantis was part of a conglomerate of 10 other kingdoms that worked together as a huge empire. And the thing about this region is, I think that's what was going on here. See, look at this. This is the Balkan Peninsula. Varna's here. You go further up, the Danube and the Vincia are there. They made these incredible metal objects. They also made some very peculiar fish head statues. There are all sorts of other settlements and cultures in between, but overall, you have got one large area in a huge band from the Black Sea to the Adriatic that acts just like the empire that Plato describes. And the top half of the Adriatic used to be above ground until around 5000 BC, and they are pulling extraordinary things out of the ocean right off the coast of Croatia. And this, I really believe, is where we need to go next.